Okay, we are recording now. Hi all, welcome to the Cloud Native Special Interest Group meeting. Today we have a presentation by Sumit. So Sumit will present external fingerprint storage. This is a project he's working on as part of Google Summer of Code project. We'll have a demo, and after that we will spend some time on to design review and discuss it. I guess that's the plan. Okay, so the floor is yours. Before we begin, how do you prefer to answer the questions? During the presentations, send them right away or after that?
I'm fine either way. I on my slides, I have a Q&A slide also at the end. So.
So since we don't have so many people in the call, let's just answer them on the fly.
Perfect. Works on. So can I share my screen? So is my screen visible?
Yes, it is.
Okay, great. Hi everybody. So welcome to the Cloud Native SIG meeting and today's demo for the external fingerprint storage project, which is one of the GSoC projects for this year. So I'll be beginning. So for the agenda for today, I'll start with my personal introduction and what exactly are fingerprints and what is the current architecture, what is our vision for the project, and followed by a demo and Q&A. So who am I? I'm basically the GSoC 2020 student for this project. I'm currently pursuing a bachelor's in instrumentation and control engineering from NSIT Delhi. I started contributing to Jenkins in December 2019. Most of my contributions have been somewhat around fingerprints, which got me interested in pursuing this project for GSoC, and I'm really excited with it. I think we have worked about, we had a community bonding for 1 month, maybe less than that, and we have spent about, I think, almost four weeks into coding. So I'll be presenting that work today. So for anybody who is new to fingerprints, I'll start with just a small introduction to fingerprinting. So fingerprinting is in Jenkins is a way to track files, artifacts, or anything across the CI/CD flow. So what happens basically is that in different jobs, say you want to track, say, which artifact was used in which particular build by, say, some other job. So you need to know that which version did they use, right? So fingerprints help us identify these files, and they help basically versioning of these files, and they can be a huge benefit to different plugins. And they can also be a huge benefit in tracking down where the source of issue came. So maybe a developer, say, fixed something in a particular build and another team is on another build. So it helps, fingerprinting helps that way. In Jenkins layout, basically, we have a, this is how fingerprints UI is built. So say you have a job called demo, and so say you go to a particular build, you can click on see fingerprints beside it, and it will show you all the fingerprints that particular build recorded, and you can click on any of those fingerprints, and you'll get a view which shows that. So here it says number 1 to number 3, so it's showing that it was used in builds 1, 2, and 3 of the job demo. So that is how fingerprinting is present, is built in Jenkins. So what is the current fingerprint storage in? So the main crux around this project is that currently fingerprints are being stored in a local manner in an XML files inside Jenkins home, and that has issues, all the issues with using a physical storage disk. So basically, as fingerprints grow, they are consuming the disk storage of Jenkins master, and they're increasing reliance on the physical storage. So we cannot configure it with cloud storages, which offer benefits like pay as you use cloud storage, or, and even most of times they're cheaper. We can even configure replica sets for, say, external databases. It helps in reliability, availability. And lastly is that currently we cannot track fingerprints across Jenkins instances. So that is another aspect of this project, which maybe will come in a later phase down the line, is that we can track fingerprints across the entire, across different Jenkins instances. That is also something we want to solve in this project. So what is the vision for our project is basically in this diagram is that we can configure. So basically we want a pluggable architecture for fingerprint storage that any storage plugin can come in, implement it for that particular storage, and then store those fingerprints in that storage. So say maybe we have a MongoDB storage plugin or a MySQL or a Redis based. Any plugin can come in and we can use that to store our fingerprints. And then maybe down the line, we build another plugin, which the fingerprint external storage API plugin, so that we can track all this flow and maybe represent it in a good manner. So that is something we'll do as we go. So this is the current model and how we are going to change it. Right. So now I'll go into the demo. So here's what I'll do. Just open up a session for. Right. So if anybody wants to so we currently have a reference implementation for our plugin, which is backed by Redis. So it lives in this repository, which is Redis fingerprint storage plugin inside Jenkins CI. We have a guide also for running it locally, which I'll just walk through this basically. The API that is currently the pluggable API that we are building on Jenkins core side is actually it's an incremental build, so it's like it's still not merged, but it exists as a pull request. It's I think 4.7.3.1 in Jenkins core, right? So once we have this merged, maybe so it's still a beta API, right? So what I'll do is I'll clone a new I'll clone this repository onto my local desktop. Right. So we have, yes. So what I'll do is just cd into plugin and run this. Take a few seconds, start up.
It takes some time to start up.
Yeah, so it's ready. Just it'll take a moment or two.
Yeah, maybe you could just refresh the page because sometimes in development mode, there are behaviors which wouldn't be seen in production.
Yes. So we have Jenkins. So what we'll go to is manage Jenkins and configure system. So we have a configuration page for our plugin over here. So here is that page. So we can configure host, port, SSL, database. So Redis has integer indexed databases, and we can change timeouts. We can add credential plugins. So say at the moment, like, and we can test Redis. So it's failing because I don't have a instance setup. So I'll just start a instance locally, right? And it's on this 6379 code. So now I can test it successful. So I'll hit apply and hit save. Also, I'll start a command line interface into Redis. And select the zero database and see what is we have here. So as we can see, it's currently empty, right? So what we can do now is start a new job or create a new job. Let's call it demo for cloud native SIG freestyle project. And what I'll do is I'll add a build step. I'll add a post build action to record these fingerprints. So demo.txt is the file which will get fingerprinted. And I'll apply, hit save. So now I have this job, right? So I can start a build for this job. And I get a success, right? So if I look into this, I'll go to see fingerprints and I can see that demo.txt is being recorded and it was used in build one in this particular job, right? So now in my CLI, what happened? Okay, so I know what happened. I think I forgot to enable this particular plugin. Just a second. So what happened is that in configuration, I forgot to enable this. We probably will be changing the enabling portion to Jenkins code, but so yeah, I had to tick this box and hit apply. And I'll hit save, right? So now, like, I don't want to, so yeah, so some clashes may happen. So what I'll do is I'll just create a new job. I'll just call it demo.
Yeah, so right now you still have a in-memory representation of the fingerprints, right?
All right. So yeah, I can I can show that. So we have this here, right? Should be in, right. So yeah. So now I can go here. So now, as we can see that I have this fingerprint demo.txt, right, which was built locally. So now this should not happen in this particular build. So just record the fingerprints for demo.txt. I'll hit apply and hit save. So now in this new job that I've configured, I'll hit a build and get a success, yes. And you can see fingerprints for demo.txt in build one, right? So now let's see what happens in our CLI. Yes, so now I'm getting a fingerprint. You can check what storing. So it has the XML blob for the fingerprint. And just out of curiosity, let's see whether did it record a fingerprint or not. So this time I'll go to fingerprints. So this is the same old fingerprint. Like, I don't have any new. This is for demo cloud native. So no fingerprint was recorded for this new job that I created. And basically, we can also configure like a Docker fingerprint of say build and publish plugin, and So if it records, fingerprint facets, so they are also handled. So they also get saved in the Redis instance. So I think that's about it for the demo. Where are my slides? Yeah. So yeah, go ahead.
No, to just answer my question anyway. I wanted to ask about next steps.
Okay, so next steps for us is, so as of now, we have not implemented any savable. So basically there's a component called a savable listener inside Jenkins, and it can fire some events on some particular, it can fire some particular events at some particular times. So basically that does not get fired right now because the API is such that we need to pass a XML file to it. So maybe we'll pass a virtual file or some, or maybe we might change the API altogether. So that is one of the next steps for us, extending the API and looking at, so we can, basically what we want to do is look at plugins and see how we can help other plugins by what API we can introduce to help them down the line. Fingerprint cleanup, basically it's happening in file storage right now. So what happens is old builds get discarded. Their fingerprints get discarded routinely. That cleanup facility right now has not been implemented. Then we'll be tackling migrations. So say when a person configures an external storage, so the fingerprints that are present locally need to be migrated to the external storage. Or say if he goes back from external storage to an internal storage, so these type of migrations, or he may configure a new plugin. So these migrations are something that we want to tackle. Tracing is something that I discussed earlier across instances for Jenkins. And ORM also at the moment. So basically we leave it to fingerprint plugins to decide how they want to save these fingerprints. But Redis, like right now, is saving it as XML blobs. So maybe we want to change that to something which is more queryable in the database. So these are some of the things we might be working on in the next few months. So I have some links at the end of the slides, but yeah, before that it's Q&A. So basically if anybody has any questions and or any suggestions would be really nice for our project.
Thanks for the presentation. So, are there any questions or comments from others? Okay. So here, maybe you could screen share the current job because it's one of the important topics. So we would like to really learn the Jenkins enhancement proposal for this project, similarly to other pluggable storage apps. And yeah, for that, I guess it still needs some feedback from potential stakeholders so that we can ensure that the draft represents all concerns. Just to clarify for those who are not familiar with the job process, there will be a draft stage. So basically it's a formally consistent job for discussion. And this is the plan for the next phase. But if you see any major issues or topics to be addressed, it's a good time to discuss that. So it's added to the draft and referenced for the future discussion. Anyone?
I'll do a link to the chat in case anybody wants to read it.
Our current plan is to ship an alpha version within the first coding phase. So basically it's, let's say, by the end of the month. In addition to job, there is a pull request to the Jenkins core. Basically, this pull request becomes the major topic for the alpha release, because we still need the API to be released in public. For that, we use all standard features like beta annotations, etc. But yeah, from those who are on the call, it would be great to get feedback whether you see anything major today which needs to be discussed before we press it with the merge. Because yeah, function-wise, it works pretty well right now. It also passes all tests. It got some additional test coverage as a part of the project. So personally, as a reviewer, I am tempted to say that it's ready to be merged. Okay. I wonder what the others think, especially JC, Vincent, because they've been working on other pluggable storage implementations before. Okay. Do we have any open comments on that pull request at the moment?
I think just one for that. I'll configure. I discussed yesterday, right? That enable button that I just showed. We need it at core side. So I'll probably just add a UI for configuring that from a drop down inside Jenkins core. That is the only thing that's left.
This problem actually brings up one problem about extensibility, because in Jenkins we have two extensibility models. One is factory as an extension point. So you have an object which can produce fingerprint storage, but the extension point is this factory. Another approach is to actually have a fingerprint storage extension point on its own. So both approaches have their own advantages and disadvantages. And for example, if you want to support multiple fingerprint storages, for migration paths, maybe it's better to think about the factory approach. I'm not 100% sure about that, but in principle it looks to be feasible for this particular case.
Yeah, I would say for a beta API, you can probably just keep it as simple as possible and just activate the new storage unconditionally when this plugin is installed. If there are multiple implementations and a lot of users, then you can start to think about, does it make sense to have multiple implementations simultaneously? Do you need to control which one is used in certain folders? Do you need to mark which engine was used for a given build, things like that? But it's probably premature to do things like that now. So they had the same question with JEP 210, which was about pluggable logging, and JEP 202, which was about pluggable artifacts. So for 202, we wound up creating a configuration UI for this. For 210, there's still nothing at the moment.
Well, there was a prototype, we just didn't match it. Yes, but both stories finally ended up with using factory as an extension point. Because in that case, what was our solution, for example, for build histories, etc.? Because both stories actually depend on the build histories. And there we were able to just keep a storage reference right inside the build metadata. And hence we didn't have to worry about the migration flow, because our migration flow was that you introduce new storage, old builds can work with old storage, and eventually when you delete all this history, you don't longer need it, or something like that.
Yeah, there are different design choices in terms of how much information about the external storage you actually want to keep in Jenkins build metadata. For the artifact manager S3, we chose to, the artifact manager records the fact that it is using S3 for a particular build, but it does not record the details such as the name of the S3 bucket that's part of Jenkins global configuration. And we did that intentionally so that, for example, you could rename a bucket and only change one spot in Jenkins global configuration, and you would still have access to historical build records that way. So depending on what the usage model is and how important access is for historical builds, you can make different choices about where to keep different pieces of information and where they should be updated.
So Jesse, what would be your advice for fingerprint storage? Because it's not really using builds, it's rather system level storage.
Right, it refers to builds by ranges, but yes, it is system level storage essentially. I haven't thought about it enough to really have an opinion.
Yeah, it might be a bit difficult, though. Yeah, our advantage is that fingerprints have unique IDs, so potentially we could somehow match it on the level of fingerprint IDs. So if ID exists in the existing storage, just keep using that, and for new, you can choose the default storage. It becomes a lot more tricky if you want to somehow really operate with multiple storages based on folders, etc. But I think that these use cases are rather out of the scope for GSoC project.
Yes.
Because it's really for large scale instances, and to do that, we need a lot of feedback so that we design it properly.
Yes, I think people running large enough servers that they would benefit from external storage are probably willing to do some extra manual setup or migration or something like that. So it's more important to not worry so much about those kinds of things at this stage, I think.
Mm-hmm. Redis is a good choice because we also do not have issues with internal parallelization when we use Redis. If we took other storage like Elasticsearch, there would be a lot of architectural issues on that side. But in principle, it would have been easier to use Elasticsearch to search the data. But for storage as is, when we store blobs, Redis looks to be a perfect choice.
Just one question about the keys. Currently, at least the file fingerprints in Jenkins use MD5 hashes. We would like to replace that with SHA-256 or similar in the future. I'm just wondering if that has any relationship to this, or if the interface that you're choosing will automatically support different kinds of hash algorithms if we switch to them in the future.
So I think Ule had the same thing in mind when we switched our terminology to IDs. So at the moment we are in our API, we have left it flexible enough that when we do make the switch to say, maybe you can choose between different hashing algorithms, then the same API can work even then.
Yeah, maybe it makes sense to show the code here, because I guess it's already integrated in this pull request.
Yeah, so this is fingerprint storage, right? So here we've used the ID terminology. So we've not used MD5 markers and for this particular API.
And
so we can change the implementation of that get hash string in the future if we need to.
Right.
Yeah, so basically when we were discussing the API, yeah, first of all, this API is behind the beta annotation, so it can be changed later if needed. But yeah, there was a discussion of what we want to use there, either passing byte array or whatever right inside API or strings. I believe that our decision was to postpone the decision until we see all the use cases for that. Because, yeah, the specifics of API in Jenkins are that there is already a lot of conversions between byte strings and strings. And if we could reduce number of these conversions, it would be also better for performance, etc. So yeah, I think it's subject to change.
Yeah, so you suggested this, and for at least for Redis, we were as it is using strings, so it made sense at least for Redis, but in future, if we find that does not, we can change it.
Yeah, I think the only important thing for this API is to make sure that you've identified all of the access patterns and so that you know what the correct keys are. I think for fingerprint storage, it's relatively simple. You know, you can put a fingerprint, but the only query really is, I'm giving you an ID and I want to know a set of build records associated with that, and I can get a single response with all of that data as one, say an HTTP response or something like that. You know, for some other kinds of storage systems like JUnit, for example, it's a lot more complicated to try to decide what kinds of queries we might want to support. But here, I think there's no, for example, there's no need for an efficient way of finding all of the fingerprints produced by one job or something, because there is no Jenkins feature that does that. Right? The only thing we do is look up a particular fingerprint and get builds back from it.
Yes and no, because there are plugins which list all fingerprints. For example, you can open a UI in build and there is see fingerprints action, which basically lists all fingerprints for build. There are also inverse searches, for example, on fingerprints pages. So yeah, for queries, I don't think that it's fully done deal how it would look like.
So you're saying, given a build, enumerate all associated fingerprints. Yes, that certainly needs to be supported by the API.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, so that would need to be added to this extension point.
Yeah. Also, maybe lookup APIs, so where you just check for existence, etc., without really pulling the data and deserializing that. And yeah, there might be a lot of iterations, but for fingerprint storage, we actually have an advantage, because the number of use cases currently in Jenkins is not that high. So it's artifacts, it's credentials, to some extent it's Docker images. And there are existing plugins, so we can just take a look at these use cases, maybe create some benchmarks using Jenkins test harness, etc., and yeah, start from there.
Right, yeah, I think the number of plugins are potentially affected by the API is very small. Mm-hmm. Credentials, Docker Commons, or Docker workflow.
Docker traceability, if it still works.
Yeah, but yeah, so as long as we have a pretty small set of places to look for all of the valid use cases, as far as I know. But you do need to do that search. So you need to go through and do some sort of text search of open source Jenkins plugins looking for interesting uses of fingerprints and decide if those uses are doing something that would be covered by this API, or if they're not, if they're doing something important enough to add.
That's right. Yeah. Anyway, it's a great start because basically you'll have something working by the end of the first phase. So if you get an alpha release, then you'll probably get some feedback from users. Fingerprints is probably not the biggest offender in terms of disk space, etc., but still it's a nice isolated use case we could address. And it would give us more insights for what we do next for other storages.
Yeah, for some users, it can be pretty big. For example, if you use the pipeline Maven plugin and don't turn off the feature to keep fingerprints, you can quickly get multi-gigabyte databases.
Yeah. And actually, it's a good subject to explore because pipeline Maven is quite widely used plugin. So why not? I really didn't think about focusing testing on this plugin, but it might make sense. And right now, Pipeline Maven plugin also has its own local database. So maybe there could be also some opportunities to see whether it could be at least partially integrated with the fingerprint storage. I'm not sure.
I don't remember what that database is being used for exactly. I think it's snapshot tracking or something.
Yeah.
Which so is related to fingerprints, certainly, but not exactly the same. You could maybe re-implement that on top of fingerprints. I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it might be interesting because otherwise somebody would have to maintain this pipeline Maven plugin databases. And it already has at least two or three. So it had H2, it had Postgres, and it had MySQL or MariaDB. So it has had three backends, if I'm right. But so any additional feedback or comments?
Oh yeah, I just checked that question about the lookup of fingerprints per build. And that doesn't seem to be an issue as far as I can tell, because that's stored as a run action.
Yeah, I believe it's the storage limitation at the moment. Because we have file system storage, and we do not really cache fingerprints or whatever, so we load them on demand. Mm-hmm. So architecturally, in order to get any kind of feasible performance without really query operations or whatever, we were dumping fingerprint IDs and actions. So we were persisting these actions, and basically this database, it still exists, but it exists as an action, not in the database itself.
Right. So, a nicer approach would be to allow this fingerprint storage extension point to turn off fingerprint action and have the equivalent functionality be re-implemented by a proper indexed search in a database. I'm not sure if that's something you could do in Redis exactly, because that's something you would more do in a relational database, perhaps. I don't know Redis.
Redis is relational enough, I would say. Well, it might still pose some issues with indexing, but I think it's a topic which could be researched.
Yeah, that would be nice, because the implementation of fingerprint action has some complicated optimizations in it to try to minimize the amount of keep memory being used in each case, because that's often been a performance problem for us. So if we could just keep that out of the build record entirely and just look it up from external storage if and when that information is needed, that would be much nicer.
Definitely. Does anybody have any new use cases for fingerprints beyond artifacts, credentials, and or images? Anywhere where you would like to see fingerprints?
Sense, but it might be interesting to see if there's any useful interaction with the artifact repository like Nexus or something like that. So if your build is uploading artifacts to Nexus, for example, should we have the ability to query, which already does its own hashing. I'm not sure if it does any kind of index of those hashes, but is there some sort of interesting interaction we could have with that so that you would be able to see not only the Jenkins build that produced some given file, but also look it up in Nexus or vice versa? I don't know if there's anything to do here, but it's something, if you're thinking about the use cases for fingerprints and how that relates to external systems.
Yeah, it would be interesting, especially since Artifactory on Nexus are quite popular. There will be discussions about creating native artifact manager for that. I believe it hasn't happened yet, but in principle it would be possible and maybe useful for some companies. So, yeah, nice use case. I was also thinking about using fingerprints for script approval. So in Jenkins, we have a script security engine where in some cases you can approve scripts or particular pipeline commands or methods for being used. So I wonder whether it would make sense to add more traceability there. So if you participated in UI UX hackathon, Wadik following year presented a new UI, which adds some additional tracing for script security, but maybe with fingerprints we could go even further.
Yeah, I don't think you should use fingerprints for that. I mean, first of all, it should be a very small number of items, and ideally zero if you're running Jenkins properly. And second, it has much more serious security implications than fingerprint matching does. So I would keep that separate.
I'm just making notes. Yeah, thanks. So, any additional feedback? Yeah, I think that we should really target integrating this pull request at least as beta, with all disclaimers. But yeah, I did some testing for file storage. It basically works as is, so pretty much like Sumit presented during the demo. Contributes to the code refactoring, which is also really a great thing because fingerprint code is not exactly the most structured code in the Jenkins core. It's not that big, but yeah, we can do a lot of improvements there. Okay. So if there is no more feedback, thanks a lot to Sumit for the presentation. And yeah, looking forward to see it in production.
Me too.
Yeah, thanks all for your participation. If you have any questions, we have a Gitter chat where which you can join and where you can ask any questions. So I think we will share this presentation after the call. So you can find all the references there. Yeah. Thanks all. Also the recording.